Ricardo, the floor is yours. Thank you very much for being here with us. We're looking forward to hearing your speech.
Okay. Oh, thank you, Alexandre. Firstly, I would like to say thanks to Alexandre for inviting me to share some thoughts about our research, because we did it together. For me, this invitation, in fact, was a great opportunity to reconnect with my research. Although I am very proud about what we did together, I have to confess that I am a little disconnected from the research environment, but this was a very good opportunity to read the papers again, to come back to my notes and everything. I don't know if it was part of Alexandre's plan to attract me back to the research, maybe to launch, as Guillermo said, the LATAM or something like this in the near future. But I have to say thanks to Alexandre to having me here in the for this opportunity. Let me introduce myself. If you Google me, you will find that I am a former executive from the internet and information technology business. I worked for more than 20 years with telecommunications. I worked at a newspaper, building portals and selling products to in the business-to-business environment, but also to consumers. And then I decided to do my master studies and after this my PhD with Alexandre. And now I am a professor of information systems. I work at two different business schools that are connected. EASY is the school here in Brazil where we deliver programs from IESE, the business school from Spain, one of the top 5 or 10 in the world. I work in São Paulo and Barcelona. Before the pandemic crisis, I was traveling to Barcelona like a 4 or 5 times per year to teach there, but now we are doing everything online. Here in Brazil, we returned with the classes this year. And I also work as a consultant and board member, and maybe because of these responsibilities, I don't have enough time to get good things like research and more papers and academic work. This is something about the school. If you are interested in getting more information, we can talk about it later. We work with executive education to high profile executives. Our main focus is the general manager of the companies. We will talk in this conversation about the research I did during my doctorate. I hope you had the opportunity to read the papers that were indicated as a pre-work for this discussion, but if not, it's not a big issue. You can read it after. This is the first one. It discussed the IT acceptance concept and words and semantics about how to explain technology use within the organization, but not just talking about acceptance, but talking also about appropriation, about embracing technology. The second one, it works more like a summary of our research. I believe this is a good summary of our findings. And finally, the last one talks more about appropriation practices. We will discuss it a little when showing the main findings of our research. But I would like to start by telling you about my personal motivations regarding this subject. When I started my master's studies almost 14 years ago, I had a first contact with the theory that tries to explain the use of information technology by individuals. It is the technology acceptance model we were talking about. This is the model, a very, very it's a simple model. In fact, it's based in the theory of reasoned action. It's quite obvious because it says that if someone perceives usefulness, like if someone sees an advantage in a particular technology, and this individual thinks that it will be easy to use it, meaning a low perceived personal cost in using it, no risk, no harm, this individual will use this technology. And here there is the first doubt that we have about the technology acceptance model is sometimes they are talking about acceptance, sometimes they are talking about use. And in fact, what they are measuring is a kind of acceptance. It's a very rational thinking. It was published the first time in 1989 by Professor Fred Davis. I had the opportunity to meet him in Arkansas when I was as a visiting scholar there. Despite this simplicity, there are a lot of critics regarding the what in fact the model is explaining, because it's not clear if it's showing effective use or just some level of acceptance. And the main question I proposed, in fact, during my doctorate studies, this is a meme, this is a joke about to accept or not to accept. Is that the question? Is this the relevant question that we want to address when analyzing the use of IT in organization? I prepare a slide with some context here to put everybody on the same page. Organizations adopt IT looking for positive outcomes. This is the idea about investing in IT. But to generate these positive outcomes, employees have to use the adopted IT artifact. They have to apply the artifact to processes, to tasks, to come up with some results. The issue here is if the adoption is voluntary. There's a difference here, because you can choose to use or not to use the IT artifact. They may accept or not to apply the artifact in the tasks and the processes. In the organization decided for the adoption of the artifact, but the user has to apply it to the processes. In this case, when the use is volitional, you can apply TEM, because in fact the theory where TEM is based considers the volitional use as one condition to apply the model. This is not clear in TEM, but it's very clear in the model where Dave's based his doctorate dissertation. And if you perceive usefulness and the system is easy of use, there's an intention to use, and finally, you use the system. The problem appears on where when the use is mandatory, because in fact, most part of applications in organizations, the use of a system is not volitional. This is mandatory. And here we have some problems, because if you must use some technology, TEM loses the explanational power, and now we have the UTOUT, the as I said here, the Venkatesh developed, and I had also the opportunity to be with him in Arkansas, the Unified Theory of Acceptance and Use of Technology. Venkatesh was one of the students of Fred Davis, and he tried to increase the model with different variables, and even with a variable talking about the volitional use of technology. If the system is voluntary, all the variables have explanational power. The problem is if you turn on the problem is if the system is mandatory, all the variables but the social influence lose the power. And this is a sufficient proof that the model has a big problem regarding the more common organization environment, because organizations, they have to apply the technology in a mandatory way. And maybe the social influence is your manager saying to you, you have to use. This is a very powerful social influence to use a new technology within the organization. And here, for this situation, when you must use it, we have a lot of problems. Because how does users really use the IT artifact? Because sometimes they can start using in different ways, and not the same way organizations planned. I can give you an example. When I was working in a telecommunications company, and we decided to implement CBIL as our customer relationship management system. And in the past, sales people, they used to register all the relationship in spreadsheets. We had a joke that only works in Portuguese, sorry, but SAP, SAP, Sistema Avançado de Planilhas, a lot of spreadsheets connected to make control and register of all the history of customers inside our company. We decided to implement CBIL. Looking the reports, looking the logs and everything, we figure out that everybody was using the system every day, and we were very happy about it. But when we started to analyze the way people, sales guys were using the system, they were inputting all the information in the system, but at the end of the quarter or at the end of the month, they were downloading all the data to a spreadsheet using pivot tables to retrofit the reports to accommodate to the previous reports they used to have. And this was not planned by us nor by CBIL, but they were using in a different way, wasting a lot of time by doing it. And this was a very unfaithful appropriation of technology, as we will discuss later. Do they use the IT artifact as expected by the organization, as this example shows? How do users appropriate the IT artifact in their activities? Is a faithful appropriation or not? And finally, how do they change tasks themselves and the artifact while using it? Because it's not a matter of a dichotomic answer, like they are using or not, they accept or not. There are a lot of different levels of use, and we try to address these different levels in our research. And based in this single slide, I can show you the whole context of our research. We came up with this general research question: how do users deal with mandatory IT artifacts to accomplish individual and organizational goals? Because the organization spent a lot of money, they put a lot of budget and effort to buy or to develop the system. But if the users start to change or not to adopt as the organization planned, some inefficiency is created here. Almost the same questions I read before. And before going further in this explanation about our research, I would like to clarify two sets of words, because this is important considering the findings and the conclusions of our research. The first set of words is system and technology, because we decided to talk more about information system and not just about information technology acceptance. And one way to explain it to you is in our research, we consider the information system, as a lot of authors do, the information system, in fact, is formed by the information technology artifact, but also by processes, knowledge, structures, people. And then we have the information technology. Part of these things can be classified as information technology. We don't see people in structure as information technology. Maybe some part of structures we can classify in this way, but knowledge, processes, and artifacts can be for sure classified as information technology. And TAM is focused in analyzing if people accept the artifact. Just this, as you could read in the papers, our research findings point to development of a personal information system while users are dealing with the adopted artifact. It leads us to the second set of words. In this first frame, I would like to make sure that we are talking more about the information system as a set of things and not just about the information artifact or the technology artifact. The second set of words is the difference between use acceptance, as I already told you. There's one paper we presented in one of the AMSIs conferences, where we try to analyze all the words that we could use to describe the relationship between users and artifacts, because it's not a dichotomic situation like they use or they do not use. There are a lot of differences. Here I put these arrows to explain. In mandatory situations, the user has to use it. In fact, in this point, the user has to tolerate the artifact. And if there are no problems, and maybe the use can generate a kind of embracement between technology and users. We could discuss what we are doing right now during the pandemic with the new uses for video conferencing tools like Zoom or Google Meet. The tools were designed for companies, for schools, but people were using for weddings, for parties, for happy hours, for different kinds of use. And we believe there are a lot of shades of gray here, because it's not just black and white. And in this paper, we are more focused in this discussion as part of our research. And this new approach towards the problem drove us to propose a theoretical background different from Tam and Utaut to analyze the relationship between users and technology. We decided to apply the social construction of technology framework and its components. It had been used to analyze the innovation process in a historical perspective, not a Pinch and Beaker. They studied the evolution of some technologies like a bicycle, backlight, lamps, and so forth. We applied it to our research problem. It was, I believe, the first time somebody did it, because we tried to apply not using historical data, but interviews, analyzing the interpretive flexibility, the social groups, and this phenomenon of interpretation, closure, and stabilization. And we believe this is a very good approach, because the definition of Scott, the social construction of technology, is based in these different interpretations from, like, the organization has an intent when investing in a new system, but users sometimes they have a different intents, different motivations. They don't want to be controlled, and this kind of negotiation between social groups offers to the artifact different meanings. I put here in some slides some figures to show you some ideas from the social construction of technology. Here, the first one is where different social groups develop different interpretations regarding the artifact. And each social group, considering background, knowledge, intentions, they attach to the artifact some meanings. After this, we have the social group. Each social group sees different problems in using that artifact or that technology, and based on this, these groups come up with possible solutions. They propose, they negotiate among the social groups, like with the example with the bicycles. At the beginning, the bicycles were used just for men, and it used to be a very, very dangerous artifact, and with a lot of different interpretations, they came up with different solutions that allow the bicycle to be used for more social groups, for more people. And this is the final example I have here. Just the innovation process is not linear in this perspective, and we think that something similar happens to information technology within an organization. Because if you think about a very basic technology like a Dropbox, for example, you can use Dropbox in different ways, and you will discover new applications and you will check with your friends and coworkers new ways to use Dropbox in your activities. In the case we analyze using Dropbox to receive papers from your students or to deliver handouts to your students. This is a kind of different applications when you have a flexible use of information technology. And the second framework we used was the adaptive structuration theory from the Sainz and Poole. Because we were interested in the expression, because the adaptive structuration theory was also concerned about how users relate to technology and the components involve the spirit of technology, a very high level word to explain about the intentions connected to the technology. There is an objective spirit and a subjective spirit. Sometimes companies explain to users what is the objective spirit, what they are looking for when investing in a new ERP or CRM or something like this, or a video conference tool. But sometimes this is not very well communicated and users started to build their own interpretations about the systems. This was the second framework we used. And here in this table, I try to make a summary about our new approach after the literature review, after the context we found, after the theoretical frameworks. We try to compare our new proposed approach to the current paradigm represented by Tam and Utaut. The first difference here, we are talking about mandatory setting is the most common situation in organization. We think this is better than analyzing the voluntary setting because this is not the regular situation that we find in organizations. The second point is this is not just about acceptance. We want to analyze the real use of technology in the organizations. The artifact is not fixed because when we analyze like an academic portal, our objective of study, there are many different uses, different interpretations, different levels of use regarding this information technology artifact. The users socially construct the artifact based in the knowledge, in the previous experience with it or the perceptions. The interpretations are negotiated among users. In fact, we found that no closure is achieved based in what we found in the field research, because the system is so complex. There are so many opportunities, there are so many options in using it that every user is not capable to use all the features. Every time they are discovering new features, every time they are repurposing the features, and constructive to apply a less deterministic and rational and psychological perspective, to use a constructivist sociological perspective, and open to multiple approaches and methodology, and not a positivistic approach like Utaut and Tam methodology and models. And the field research, I believe you had the opportunity to read in the papers, but we decided to study an academic portal, our IT artifact. We read all the manuals, we visited the developer's website, how the company that developed the system used to promote the system, the characteristics, the features. We talked to the portal manager, the responsible for the implementation process, training, reporting, control, and everything. We talked to him. We also talked to 14 lecturers, the users, using the snowball approach. We were asking for the interviewees to indicate more people, and we talked to different we talk to people with different point of views about the IT artifact, the different levels of use, promoters and not so happy people with the IT artifact. We talked also with the department chair, the department we talked to the professors, the current department chair, the former department chair, because we try to capture a historical perspective in this sense. And also this is not in the papers you read, but we also talked to the manager who was responsible to implement the same IT artifact in a different organization, to capture if they're the culture or the kind of organization or the history of the organization could affect in some way our interpretation about the findings. What we have found, our data shows that the relationship is much more complex than the current paradigm can really describe it. This is like a term is very, very easy to apply. And Guillermo was saying there are a lot of different implementations of term with different variables, with different context. But in fact, there is a strong explanation power, but for what? This is the big question here. The relationship it's much more complex than the Uthout and Tom can explain. There's a gap between what the organization adopts and what users eventually use. As the example I told you about the CRM system in the company, there's a difference between the spirit, and also we can use the faithful appropriation in the unfaithful appropriation, because sometimes the intentions are clear and users will adopt as easy as the organization had planned, but sometimes the objectives are clear and users do not want to be controlled, or they have their own ideas about the IT artifact. Different interpretations and levels of enrollment continue being negotiated among users. There is no final closure, as I said before, because the system is something live and users interpret, repropose, apply in different ways the system, and we couldn't find, in fact, something that is 100% closure to new interpretations or new uses. And the actual use of IT artifact is conditioned by changes in the artifact and in the tasks. This is one of the diagrams. It's published in one of the papers. This is one analysis where we are comparing the adopted artifact by the organization, and here we can use the term adopted, because the organization, the decision makers, decided to buy or to develop the system with a lot of different features. Now we can think about a design thinking, a lot of different development methodologies to capture the customer history, customer features and everything. But in fact, there is a system that was adopted by the organization. But when you go to the usage level, you start to verify some different behaviors here, because there are some features that are applied as is, like a very, very simplistic features or very common features. But sometimes the users refute or reject some features, or they don't put value in that features. Sometimes they adapt some of the features. The producers, the developers, they thought about the feature with one intention, one interpretation. But the users, they start to think in different uses. Here in Brazil, we have an expression to it, jeitinho. It's an expression that generated a lot of research. When I was studying the workaround, I found a lot of papers talking about jeitinho from Brazil, the way Brazil.
Just the other day, sorry to interrupt. The other day, people were saying that developers in Holland now use the term gambiarra, which is also a Brazilian term. because there are so many Brazilian researchers there, Brazilian developers there, that they introduced the term gambiarra, which also relates to jeitinho. These two words, they mean sort of a workaround, right?
Explain
to people, it's a way of doing it differently. Usually Brazilians always think in a cleverer way, but many times it's a way that corrupts the original spirits.
Good point. In Alexandre, I found a definition from MIT talking about hacking. Today is it's attached to a very negative connotation of hacking, but in fact in 1975 in MIT, they coined this hacking terminology to talk about something like a gambiarra, jeitinho, like to repropose something in a creative way to accomplish new things or something like this. This is something happens all the time in the use of technology. Other options, the replacement and complementation. In fact, at Yezi, we have a contract with Microsoft to use Microsoft 365, and we have OneDrive, but my department, we use Dropbox, and we are paying twice because a lot of professors prefer to work with Dropbox instead of OneDrive. This is one example of a replacement. We are paying for both tools, but we are using Dropbox instead of OneDrive. In complementation, it's when you connect, for example, a pen drive or a form, a Google Forms, or something that wasn't present in the regular information system, and you're trying to complement it. This is one of our findings to classify this. This could help developers to improve the solution based in the way users deal with the IT artifact. Other interesting finding by studying this research case, we realized that each user in fact builds his or her own self-developed information system. The idea here is, organizations, they buy a lot of things to be applied in the processes. They call it the information system in place. But in fact, what we found was that the user is selecting new tools, changing the tasks, changing the processes, adapting something, and building this, the self-developed information system, not just what the organization chose, but also what the user chose to be applied in the task, in the process. And in fact, after some time, what happens, let me move one for, different from the information system that the organization thinks everybody is using, there's an information system in use that is the sum of the aggregation of the organizational information system and the personal information system that every employee, maybe even customer or partners, attach to the regular information system. This is something that we should investigate more. We should research more about how can it influence the results, the products, the system, the process. And another finding that is not in the papers you read, but in the dissertation is, and it's more connected to the title of this presentation. We had to find a 2x2 matrix. It was like I tried to have one 2x2 matrix, because every time I'm teaching, I explain that during our engineering graduation, we study calculus, algebra, a lot of things to try to explain the world, but it's simpler when you have a 2x2 matrix. You can choose two variables and explain everything. Here, our 2x2 matrix. Companies have to analyze the changes users are promoting in the IT artifact or in the task. And we could classify four different behaviors here. The first one is no change is applied, nor to the artifact, nor to the task. And this is the passive as is appropriation. One example is the attendance registration in the case of our objective of study, the registration of students in a class. It's very easy to do, no pain, and let's do it as the portal asks us to do it. One different level is when you have to change your task due to some limitation in the artifact. This is the technology push change. The task is adapted. It's like a Procusto myth about like cutting parts of somebody to accommodate in the bed of his hostel. And this is the idea here. And using one example, using slides to teach, because in some interviews, I heard somebody, look, I teach math. Math, it's easier when you do it on board, not in a slide. It's like it's not the perfect tool to teach math. But as the portal is asking me to publish all the material, I decided to publish everything on PowerPoint, and I wrote all the math equations in the PowerPoint, and I am changing my way to do things due to the artifact limitations or the intentions that the organization had related to the artifact. Other part here, when you have to change the artifact without changing the task, is what we call the demand pool here. The artifact is adapted to the process, to the person, to the user. The example we used here is, for example, connecting Google Forms to one activity in the portal, because I would like to have some features that the portal is not delivering, and I am adding something to the artifact, my personal system, to have this new feature available for me. And finally, when you have both, when you have changes in the tasks and in the artifact, here, this is the what we call the active construction of one owns IS, and I am in total control of my personal information system. And this is one of the stories we heard is professors used to leave handouts at the copy desk, and now they realize that with the portal this is not necessary, and they can use Dropbox as a way, together with the activity and the artifact, to deliver the handouts of classes to the students, or to receive posted to-do lists or exercises or papers or anything, projects. And this is some classification about the level of change regarding tasks and artifacts. For organizations, here in the left side of the 2x2 matrix, we have to think about how to increase the obtained results, personal and organizational, in the sense that we are using the artifact as is, but sometimes we are changing processes, activities, and it can generate inefficiency or security problems. We can talk a lot about different issues that can appear from this kind of change. And finally, the right side here is more focused in the workaround, like the gambiarra, jeitinho, because you are dealing with the task and artifact in a way to change, or both, or at least the artifact to accomplish your objectives and your goals. And finally, this is my last slide, some opportunities to move further. Maybe some of you get some interest here from our perspective. One idea is to apply different theoretical concepts, because we could use the structuration theory in a micro perspective, not talking about organizations or big systems, but with small tasks and individuals. To use the actor network theory, it's a very, very, how can I say, it's a very polemic, it's a very discussed methodology, but it could be used because we are talking about the relationship between actors and technology in a network. Another idea is to analyze the internal relationships within the self-developed IS. This idea about the self-developed IS, how the level of flexibility or knowledge generates adaptations, level of different adaptations. If I have a different levels of knowledge among technicians, professors, executives, how do they apply it to the adaptations they do? I have a lot of examples now with the new technology that we had to apply to the online classes, a lot of different implementations depending on the knowledge. Another interesting relationship between the social influence, we could use social network analysis to understand if I learned something with Alexandre in this class with this idea about using Moodle, using Google Meet, I can apply it to my self-developed information system. This is another idea. Another idea to investigate the effects of the self-developed system, wasted energy, costs, problem-solve and innovation, more related to the organizational level, what the self-developed IS is generating in gains or problems to the organizations. And finally, cross-cultural studies. Is the phenomenon related to Brazilian culture? The idea about jeitinho, it's something, or if we do the same study in Germany or other country, more rational, if they use the same strategies like the Dutch guys learning from Brazilian developers, maybe it's a good way to start to think about the gambiarras and so on. This was what I had to say. I say thank you again, and I'm open to hear your doubts, critics, suggestions. Alexandre is the co-author of all the papers, and we can deal together with the questions.
So I'll send you the hard questions and solve the right. Ricardo, before you get rid of your slides, could you go back to, and before we open for questions, could you go back to that slide in which you showed the different behaviors that people had with respect to assistance that was proposed to them? That one perfectly, yeah. So in this, when we think of this slide here, guys, we thought, well, when Ricardo got to this, you know, and this was about maybe what?
Seven years ago,
we thought, gee, we have gold here, because if this is given to the developers are going to be able to improve their systems dramatically based on the knowledge of the users. And you know the kind of response that we get when we show this to the developer? Basically what the developer says is, they're trying to corrupt my system.
My system, yeah.
My system had a spirit that should not be corrupted, and I planned everything in a perfect way, and these guys are sabotaging what I'm doing.
And Alexandre, I will add also, because now I'm dealing a lot with like agile methodologies, with a Scrum. And when we analyze, for example, Scrum, they are trying to fix it with the history, not like the history, the user's case, the history. But it's not solving all the problem, because as you said, this is not related to development phase, but we are talking about the usage phase. We are talking about the use, and not just about we are trying to solve some issues, some problems, and developers could use it a lot. But as you say, they see it like this is my son. I don't want to corrupt my original idea, and the user has to implement those adaptations.
I see here that Andrea is saying in the chat, unbelievable. Probably I understand that she's saying unbelievable is that the developer rejects the change that technology use proposes, but it's
no.
They
reject what I am like. Wow. Is that they reject a feedback from the end user, you know, for maybe improving the system
have
created.
What we have to think there, Andrea, is that we have...
It's an ego trip.
Yeah, we have 300 years. We have 300 years of industrial revolution pushing us towards the wrong direction, or towards, let's say, not the wrong direction, the old direction. In the past, the idea that prevailed was, well, there was a developer, there was an engineer who thought the whole process, please don't touch it. Whatever you do will disturb a process that has been cleverly designed. Nowadays, it's right the opposite, right? The process needs to be changed because the world is moving faster than we are able to as designers. So we do need that engineers and designers understand that technology in use may become a very important way of innovating. I think that was one of Ricardo's questions there in his final slide when he said, is this just a waste of energy or is this opportunity for innovation? We do believe, but that's where Ricardo stopped. And that's when Ricardo was my last doctoral student at Universidade Positivo. Then I moved to UTFPR, where our graduate program does not have a doctoral program. So we lack energy, but hopefully in this group here, there will be someone who is
taking this
research further.
I hope so.
Our assumption is that this is gold for whoever is thinking about opportunities to innovate based on what users do. And precisely, Andrea, what you were saying, we can learn from customers. We can learn from our own employees. In this case here, the research was with professors that were, let's say, hired by the university. So they were actually employees there. Yeah. We can learn from suppliers. There's so many people that can teach us something, and we just have to be open-hearted to welcome the innovation that, but that's our assumption. We still need research to be done in that way. Eleni, go on.
It's amazing to see that, because the division between developers and users occurs since the 80s, I believe. And there's still a room to think about who is the owner of the system. You construct something to share data, to share information, and you still think about who is the owner and who should control and see what is going to be developed. For me, it's impressive. And I'd like to hear from people that is not from business schools, but from IS schools, how they feel this, how they understand that in their practice.
Yeah, considering that our group here is a group that has people from business schools, but also from computer science schools, how do you feel about that? Maybe Donna, you can give us some hints of what happens there in Panama. I know that you and all of your students are computer science, right?
Okay, now I was talking and the mic was off. Okay, like I told you the last time, Alexandre, this is one of the issues that have been happening so many years ago, that the developers create these programs like an art product, but it's not an art product. It's a juice for someone. And the problem is, it's very difficult, as the we were talking before, that the developer try to meet the user's needs, because they might think that the user doesn't know what he needs. The user knows what they need, but there is a gap between what the user think or feel like he needs and what the developer understand that the user needs. And this is a gap that produced that the adoption and the adaptation takes a lot of time. Mm-hmm. Normally, I feel what I've seen over here, after the software, the application is developed, the user has to adapt to this. And that's not what should be. Now, if the answer was, this is the answer to my problem, why do I have to change 100% what I do and how I do it to adapt to something that is not familiar? So the adoption takes more time, because it's a psychological process. The adoption has to be part of what the user take as part of what he does and feel that it's part of what he needs. That's what I see over here. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's the same over there.
Yeah, and just Donna, just adding to what you said, is the issue here is I believe developers should add some process to capture how users are using the develop tool, because when you are developing something, you collect a sample of thoughts and features and ideas from users. But after collecting the sample, after developing the tool, you have to offer to everybody, not just that sample. And I believe the differences in interpretations, in adaptations appear in that point. And as you said, the developers should bring this opinion, this information to the process again, to try to improve with a bigger sample, or not just the sample, but also in different phases or stages of use of that technology. This is another I would like to add as an opportunity to increase or improve the development process.
Ricardo, may I ask, yes, or make some comments here? The point here is that I think you are talking about private, most of the time, I think, private organizations. If we, as I am researching in electronic government in public sector, the use of ICT in public sector, something that is all the time is discussed in the public sector, in ICT implementation in the public sector, is the how to call and to make the citizens co-create, help to co-create the systems and development systems. So, and many times we are seeing that we are talking with a broad profile of citizens, because we have, you know, everybody, mm-hmm. the whole population, yeah, of a city, of a country. So when we are taking account that we have so diverse profile of users, that is not exactly the same when we are talking in organization, a specific organization, this kind of problems is increasing quite a lot. So because we need to attend, you know, the poor citizens who are in the in the communities in lower classes, and then mm-hmm. we have the top classes and those who are more high level educator, you know, and who are more, have more abilities, who has less abilities to deal with technology. So some experience are increasing, came from communities that engage the citizens since the beginning of developing any kind of solution, mm-hmm. information system solution, and try to bring them since the beginning, because the way that I use this device, for instance, is quite different from person who are living in Hosnia or whatever, in Islam. So, you know, what I want to say here is that perhaps taking in this other kind of environment in account, probably you are going to see this different way, this design that you are taking here. Yes. That I understand that is related to your focus on unity analysis. That's okay. But if we change that, probably we will not apply. So,
Yeah. No, I agree. Maybe we are like analyzing in considering an organizational culture, very like high level educated people. When we go to very different segments of population, culture, maybe we should try. In fact, this is a very interesting research, because you could analyze how to improve the development process regarding different applications or different levels of knowledge or access to the
culture and not only culture, like regions, you know, related to language, different kind of language that we are dealing with. And you know, there are so many different variables to take in account, that must be taken in account. So it's just another discussion that I think is quite broad, this discussion. I just bring some lights, you know, from
it's interesting. Maybe one, I'm thinking more like a developer right now, and maybe one solution would be to have like APIs, application program interface, and you have pieces of application developed in different ways to different cultures or segments.
This is important, sorry Ricardo, but this is important to bring, you know, the users to in that moment to construct, to build these systems and apps or whatever. Uh-huh. You know, probably you don't need to do that in the whole if you are dividing in the whole system, if you are dividing in this kind of levels of development. Yeah, but I think especially on the in the interface of the device of the system, probably it will be very useful if you call them to you know, to co-create, and it could be also applied not only for citizens but also for in the private sector, you know, in the private organization. So that's my comments. And okay. Thank you, Ricardo, for your research. Yeah, thank you.
While we're still waiting for other questions there from our crowd here, one thing that maybe, Ricardo, you could comment about was you had challenges in deciding where to perform your research, because of course Ricardo assumed that there were users that felt that they did that questioned the systems that were proposed to them, right? And even if all users do that, not all users are empowered in the sense that they feel that they can either, you know, work around or change the system, change the technology in use. Many users may feel that they are a weak link in the, let's say, in the whole system, and that they should not challenge the developer because the developer knows it better. So Ricardo had chosen, before he got to professors in a university, and professors are, I don't know if they are empowered, but they feel empowered, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But he had thought of two different groups of users, and he has even made some attempts of going and talking to them, medical doctors mm-hmm. and lawyers. And judges. Can you tell us a little bit of what happened when you went checking systems in those situations, Ricardo?
No, yeah. As far as I remember, I tried to contact, because we were looking for places where we could do the research, and we knew the situation with the professors, because we were looking for a very volitional environment, like a place not volitional but mandatory, but with a high level of flexibility, and we could find it with the professors, because the professors they had a lot of flexibility in using the portal. With the doctors and judges, we couldn't find the same flexibility, because there are more rooms, more like compliance aspects to be followed. This is one aspect. I don't remember if you remember another issue, but they were more closed than professors, than the university, to allow us to discuss the research. And with, especially with doctors, they had to accomplish to a lot of different tasks without too much flexibility to deal with the IT artifact.
Right. What I remember, Ricardo, and it may not be true.
It's a legend.
Through memory, it may be something that I made up, you know, that I made sense of it over time. But what I do remember is we thought, well, doctors, I mean, doctors, medical doctors, there is gods, and then there's medical doctors, and there's
us, indeed.
Right? So we thought, well, medical doctors will never use a system if they are not completely
obliged,
or if it was not their idea or something like that. And then we got a little disappointed, because when we went to the hospitals and we saw that they were using systems and they were not complaining, and they had not designed those systems. But then, and again, so many years later, it may not be the true, you know, what truly happened, but it's my understanding of it now. What happened was that the systems did not change what medical doctors did. It did not change their work directly. It only changed the accessories. So it was, you know, and there was sometimes some resistance or so, but it was things that they very quickly noticed, well, this makes the process smoother, more efficient. It was just a matter of efficiency. And the same happens in accord with all the systems that regulate how the law pieces, I don't know how we call them, have to flow through the system. It was basically, I mean, they had a procedure, and it was followed the same way, just faster or more efficiently, right?
Yeah.
That's different to what happens with professors, and when someone asks them to use a system to teach their classes, because I don't think that Ricardo found any resistance, for example, of teachers about taking attendance using a system. Especially if the system worked, of course. If the system stopped working in the middle, then they would start.
I remembered also, because why we didn't interview with students, because something related to this, because the students, they don't have too many flexibility to change anything, and they have to use to access. They are being evaluated about it, and we decided not to interview them, because it wasn't adding anything to the analysis.
So what we thought at that stage is that professors represented a group of workers that were empowered workers, in the sense that they had a saying about the procedures with which they were involved. They could say, I'm not going to do that. In fact, I even remember that at some stage, someone asked us, well, you have to, for each class you teach, and we're not talking about COVID times, right? It was, well, many years, 10 years ago, maybe more than that. Each class you teach, you should have at least one file posted to the portal. And I said, well, that's instruction. I thought, well, I'm going to teach strategy building or something. I would ask my daughter, who's now 24, but who was then 7 or 8. I would say, give me a picture that you like. And then she gave me the three little pigs. And I said, this is good for strategy. You know, one of the pigs is a strategist there. So that's what I will post. And I posted that because I felt empowered in the sense, nobody's going to challenge that. And if they do, I will say, well, if you don't like that, you just asked me to upload a file. Didn't I do it, right? So in that sense, we thought that professors were maybe not the extreme, but as much the extreme of the knowledge worker that we could get to, in the sense that they would and they could challenge a system if they think that if they thought that the system was not precisely what they needed. Of course, if we're talking about a worker in a manufacturing line, that's not the case. But we think that in the future, we will have each time more people working in the same kind of environment that we now have professors as knowledge workers, and less people working in environments like the one that, let's say, a worker in a production line works. Mm-hmm. So we thought that we were building theory for the future, while most of the theory that we have around only looks at the past. Mm-hmm.
Guillermo,
Renata, everyone has their hands up.
I even sent you a message on WhatsApp to see when you were going to stop talking and out, but there was a long line of people raising their hand.
I'm not going to ask Guillermo, so I'm only going to read your message now, right?
Yeah.
I don't have to read it.
I remember you're not multitasking, and you're into WhatsApp, basically, right?
I'm just
a little too philosophical about this, but you remember that there, I mean, when did it happen that acceptance or adoption became more important than appropriation? And the reason I ask this is because if you think about it, both concepts go way back. Obviously, acceptance is a lot easier to study than appropriation, right? Or at least to try to measure. And if you think about it, probably acceptance and adoption are previous stages within the appropriation process. But you do not get appropriation until you modify the system, okay? Until you make it part of your everyday life, and then you make changes to better suit your needs, right? Then you get appropriation. So if we don't allow the developer to change, or the developer doesn't allow us to change, then we never get appropriation, which is, it's a contradiction in terms, because you never get to...
And I can give you an example talking about phones. If we talk about phones 40 years ago, you should you can attend your phone, you can use your phone to talk, and that's it. Now, if we talk about
phones. And I always tell everybody, who really uses this thing
to talk?
And we still call them phones, right? But the least thing they are is actually phones right now. I mean, every now and then, we use them.
You know, I still use it to phone someone, but before I have to write a Google question and asking them for the call.
you finally had to throw away your old Nokia, right? That didn't have any. It was a dumb telephone. So anyway, so the point is, I don't know. I mean, all this literature is, this is such a difficult area to study, because there is such an amount of compounding effects, don't you think, that will definitely determine many, many things. And simply, when you think of voluntariness of use, right? If it's not voluntary, you will adopt it, but not necessarily you will appropriate it.
Yep.
Or I can argue that this is a long-term effect, or is an evolutionary process in which many times that we have been forced to use the technology we didn't like, at the end, we like it and we appropriate it. But it has to be obviously a process going on that needs to be measured longitudinally and more qualitatively.
It will change a long time,
So maybe we should be focusing on doing longitudinal qualitative studies on the social process rather than just trying to measure everything one time with some quantitative survey tools that police.
For sure. Guillermo, I agree with you, because if we think about UTOUT use and technology acceptance, it's not measuring. Maybe it's measuring some kind of use, but it's a picture in a moment.
A proxy for intention to use. Intention to adopt, basically.
Yeah. It explains a lot about nothing. Yeah, this is the issue. A lot about nothing.
Absolutely. There's so many things we can talk about this, but there's not enough time. I think Renata has her hand up for a while.
Yes, I've raised my hand. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm a little shy today because I moved from Rio to São Paulo, and São Paulo is cold for a carioca girl.
Is it ever cold?
Ah, so São Paulo is terrible.
Not so cold as Curitiba.
But for someone who lives in Rio de Janeiro, it's really cold. But Ricardo, thank you very much for your talk. It's a really nice research. And we could see the expression, Alexandre's expression during your presentation, like a very proud father. So thank you very much for your
thank
work.
You. Thank you, Renata.
Okay. I just would like to make some comment about the never-ending story about the distance from developers and users. And from the point of view of someone who teaches new developers for the world, the problem is that we should start teaching them using your diagram, the diagram you had in your presentation some minutes ago, you know, by teaching them that the way people use or appropriate or adopt technology can be completely different from what they believe it will be. And instead, we start teaching them how to program, how to dominate the machine and so on. So that's, I think it's the real problem. But I totally agree with Guillermo about the terminology. And don't you think that when we use the terms use, acceptance, adoption, we are somehow, or appropriation, we are somehow reinforcing this distance? Because there are some theories, I don't know them too deeply, but that say that actually what we are doing is a common and social construction, as Guillermo said, and some of them use the word cultivate. Actually, we are cultivating the way we work, the way we use technology, the way we build technology. It's something collective. It's a collective building. So I don't know. Maybe we are reinforcing this distance
still.
When we try to understand the problem using these terms.
Yeah.
Those are my comments.
Thank you, Renata. No, thank you, Renata, for your comments. And when we were studying the acceptance model and looking for some better word to describe it, because as Guillermo said, it's intention to use sometimes and not acceptance. It's not use, real use. And what's right, we were trying, and this paper we presented at AMSI is trying to talk about semantics and as you said, Renata, maybe we are generating more confusion than explanation, but we were trying to exercise some different words, and in this paper we try to and we went to Latin, to Greek, to trying to understand the origins of each word to try to describe in a better way. But as Guillermo said, there is a lot of different points in time. There are a lot of different levels of use, levels of adoption, and I believe more now to analyze the problem in qualitative research than something that we can take a picture or make a survey to verify if they are using or not, or because what we will find, it will be like a picture of a moment of that user answering a particular question you did in that survey, but not all the richness of the use the user the user is applying to the feature. But I agree with you, Renata. I we couldn't find yet a better word to describe it. We believe appropriation is a good word, but it's it's a lot of different things as well when you say appropriation and the different levels. And again, the social construction of technology, the adaptive structuration theory can help us in this structuration processes, because we are in fact trying to explain something really, really, really complex to explain in one single word. But I agree with you that the problem with a lot of papers we analyzed talking about acceptance is this confusion about acceptance and use, and this not helping to understand the phenomenon. And we were trying to find different words, but I agree, appropriation is too broad to explain everything.
Yeah, Donna is mentioning their co-creation. We've already discussed collective intelligence a few weeks ago, and we will have a talk on co-creation in 2 weeks, right? When we have Zandra Balbino talking to us here.
Yeah, we used talking about co-creation. We used McKay. McKay's has a paper talking about co-creation, and this is a good point of. It's an interesting point of view.
But the problem, Renata, is that I think that we in information systems we got stuck with. Acceptance and adoption, and many times we still use them as synonyms, which is even crazier. And this is why when Ricardo was saying that we went back even to the, let's say, the origins of the words. I mean, adopting something comes from option, opt, right? There is an option, and usually who has the option is the owner of the company or the manager who buys the system or who pays for development. Users many times are only able to accept a system that has been already adopted by someone. And of course, we can have different levels of acceptance. It's not binary. It's not zero or one, as Ricardo showed in one of his.
And then slides. Again, you can always going to counter argue is adopt the same thing as acquired. So, I mean, we can really get lost in semantics here. Yeah. And I don't think that would be.
Guillermo, an appropriation, Guillermo.
No, yes, appropriation is a completely different thing, but I see it in different levels of sequence and school.
The levels.
Right? Uh-huh. Yeah.
But it's interesting to realize that these things happened historically. We only used acceptance and adoption as synonyms because in the early stages, maybe when Fred Davis was there studying the use of spreadsheets in organizations, it was maybe a manager or let's say a boss who bought the thing and bought a personal computer and left there on the corner of the office and said, you know, if any of you want to have a go at it, go for it. So the user was actually also adopting something because it was not compulsory as it became later on. So, but it is tough, and I do agree that the solution for this puzzle is in co-creation. If we can make developers understand that if they develop the product together with the users, we will finally reach a better situation. But again, the problem is that many designers or many developers still, and that's a feature, being an engineer, I understand that engineers work with processes and those processes are sort of linear.
And that comes from the past too, Alexander.
It comes from the past, for sure.
Developers generally, they want to hear what the user has to say, but sometimes the user doesn't know what he has to say. And sometimes developers don't listen very well. So if you put two and two together, I mean, it's a mess. And then they decide that they don't want to have a system corrupted, because if the user puts his hands on the system, then probably the system is not going to work the way it was supposed to be, right?
But there is a way we can do that.
In a way, we're protecting their invention, but in another way, probably they're being arrogant and feeling that they are artists that should not be touched. So, but a system is just as good as it serves the user.
Mm.
So if you forget that, you have nothing, no matter how good it runs, right?
By the way, Guillermo, could you send me that WhatsApp message again? I noticed here that it did not show up in my cell phone.
Well, that cell phone, my dear friend, it's probably not a very good idea, but anyway.
All right. Any other questions, guys?
The students, the co-creation aspect is really interesting in the sense that it probably goes with whatever the market of technology is doing already, because if you think about it, one of the technologies that is also always going to be changing is that is commercial. Okay, is if you have to sell it, you have to change it. Period. It's not like an in-house developer in a company. So you're going to be changing, and you're going to be doing focus groups, and you're going to be listening to the customer, and then you're going to be changing the system, and the customer is going to be participating and probably adopting it or liking it better. So it goes hand in hand in a way. Probably they interact more than they think. And if that can happen inside the company and in-house developments, that would be probably a good way to go. But then again, that's only theoretical, right?
Yeah. And Guillermo, I don't know if it's a trend or I'm more in the business side than the technological or development side. But with these new platforms like Dynamics, some platforms that are more open to new developers, like maybe companies are perceiving that they have to keep the technology open because the organization, the user, want, like a Power BI or Dynamics or something like this, they want to adapt, they want to customize, like we are using Microsoft Teams, and you can add a lot of different apps to your system. It is a path
it's a different business model, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because you leave a part open for the collective intelligence that Alexandre so much talks about, and then because you're going to benefit, right, from bringing all that knowledge and that smart people working on
building
your
new things,
and yet you keep a part of it to make your business profitable. So yeah, I mean, it's definitely these times are changing.
You know, just increase the polemic here about the words we use to discuss these things. Andrea was saying there in the chat that appropriation sounds to her as something being stolen from someone else.
cultural appropriation.
Exactly.
If you're from Mexico City, you might think that way. It's cultural background.
Any other questions, guys? Come on, the students today are very shy. You've been talking about this, right? Go ahead, please.
Let's go for the social construction.
No, Silvio has a question there. All right,
let's not a question, but a contribution, because I am really shy. No. Okay, just to explain, I received approach 8 years ago to distribute for each salesperson in a store one cell phone. And I asked why? Because the salespersons now we'll use the cell phone to take notes about this the sales, not more the paper. Okay. Easy, because the same system in the computer will be in a smartphone. Okay, we start this in the first store with 30 users to use the same system in of the computer in a smartphone. After 60 days, we didn't have we just have two users use the application. When I read the article and I saw the figure one, I was thinking about that, because we, after 80 months, we have just 200 cell phones working, not 2,000. Why? Lack of knowledge, because people don't know how to use correctly the system on a smartphone, has more screens, different form. Ability to use the smartphone, rejection because the paper was easier than the smartphone, and the resistance because it's much easier to take some notes in a paper and after some hours go to the computer and input information than use online information. So when I read this article, I was very fascinated, because it's a theory and the practical. I can see this kind of gaps in a practical way. Very interesting.
Yeah.
We are now analyzing the application and the users' opinions to rebuilding the project and understand what we have to change to roll out 2,000 smartphones.
What kind of retail was it?
Construction products.
Okay.
It's not about to say the name. In São Paulo, State of Norte.
Okay.
40 stores in São Paulo. And Rio Grande do Sul to Meleiro, more 30
okay,
stores.
Okay, yeah. Wow. So, and how are they doing nowadays? Are they using the phones or are they writing down?
200 phones, but we need to roll out 2,000.
Jesus.
Just 200 after 8 months of project. So we are rebuilding to try to do this in next month.
Okay.
Next year.
That's interesting.
Yeah, very interesting. And the figure one for me is the shows that moment in my company.
What happens?
It's very real. Good. Thank you, Ricardo, because it's a very practical thing.
Thank you, Silvio.
Violeta, go ahead.
Hi, thank you, Silvio, for your example, because I just want to bring in another one, also in from a retail store. My husband works with some of you, we may know about this programming language called COBOL. Yeah, he's a COBOL developer, and he works for he develops system for a retail company who went through this digital transformation the past few years, and they bought a few digital.
And their digital transformation included programming in COBOL.
No, actually, they are. I'll tell you. I can tell what is the chain is Casas Bahia. Yeah, and the last few years they started investing in e-commerce because they were far behind, because their main customers they go to the shops, yes. And what happened is in this process they bought some e-commerce companies, and they started changing the interface of the systems for the sellers who work in the shops. And they started, doing very fancy pictures of the products on the screen. But what happens is the sellers, the vendors, they were used to the, because on the background is still the mainframe systems, and they just put the front part in a very nice way. But the problem is that the vendors, they are so used with the screens, they just they tab, and they know exactly what they have to fill in to get the information, and then every time they started inputting information, the screen starts loading the image of the refrigerator, and it takes hours, it ages to bring the images, and the vendors were just crazy. They said, I don't want the image because I already know the product. I have the product here. Physical, and I have to be fast, because otherwise the customer just go away if it takes a long time. So they had to back up, and they had to take away all this fancy user experience stuff, because they didn't need. Yeah, they said, I don't need this, I just need a system to be faster. So that's an example close to what Silvio said. Yeah, brought. Because he said, well, I think in theory, this is perfect. We are bringing user experience and very fancy things, but they didn't need that. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Violeta.
Yeah, thank you for that. Again, it's interesting that sometimes, and we of course, we're here in the chat all playing with the COBOL thing. Of course, some of the people in the computer science side are saying COBOL is never going to die, which I find surprising, because if they said Fortran will never die, but COBOL is a language for business already. Yeah. And that only shows us how strong the legacy is.
Especially to the bankers, no? Alexander?
Banks.
The banks.
Yeah. For sure, yeah, yeah. Whoever has still has a mainframe and thousands or millions of lines of code written in those languages will still need to use them, and that will probably go forever. We're getting close to the time to leave here, but I just, when you were talking about these things with users' experience, and sometimes even new products that the users are still don't know exactly what the protocol is, I remembered something that Ricardo told me when he was still a master student or something. He worked at Telepar at that stage, which was the telephone company for Paraná in the south of Brazil. It was a state-owned company. And they were introduced mobile phones here, and people, it was not that people did not buy them. I think people even bought them, but people did not use them the way at least vendors thought that they would, because they felt embarrassed. If I were talking to Ricardo here, well, face to face, and then he would never, at that stage, he would never say, Alexandre, wait a second, because I have to pick the phone. It would be, bad manners for sure.
Yeah.
And then I hope you still remember the example.
Exactly. Yeah, we had some problems in the adoption of cell phones in Brazil, because the cell phone was attached to some how can I say it, very fancy, very like
status.
Yeah, an exhibitionist, like something, and it was a shame to attend a call in public. And the Telege decided to hire
Telege, you have to explain. Telege, the telephone company for Rio de Janeiro.
Yeah, yeah. They decided to pay to put in a soap opera a very famous actor in Brazil, José Wilker, attending a phone and talking to the phone, and no problem at all. And it was used to educate the users about the cell phone, and it's not, it wasn't a shame to use a cell phone. And then the cell phone started to sell in a better way.
So see, Fred Davis was right, to at least to some extent. If you do not train people, if people do not perceive that it's easy to use, and that the use is
no harm on
important
it
to them, things are not going to work. All right. Any other questions? Any other comments? Otherwise, I just want to present you tell you a little bit about our next talk next week. We'll go back to, a couple of weeks ago, Eleni was discussing education and how technology affected education in business, but also in other areas. And I remember that during her talk, I said, well, there's someone I want to invite. Jeff Dick was our last inclusion in the program. It was the only date that we still had available. And Jeff will come and talk to us about online education post-COVID. He has a couple of papers that he has written during the pandemic about teaching and learning and the transformation in teaching and learning that happened, because of the pandemic. And he will be here telling us about that. So thank you very much for being here with us. Thank you very much, Ricardo. It's always a pleasure to see you again and see that you're as smart as you've always been. And we'll see you all next week. Okay, bye.
Bye, ciao.